Hello and welcome to episode 13 of Let's Play Venice. We're picking up several tens of turns after I last played. So what actually ended up happening was when I last played this was in early January and we're now in May. So I really didn't go back to Civ for several months after that game, the last game I recorded. And it was for many reasons. Other games came that interested me more, and I think that game, the last playthrough I had, ended in a real sour note because I kind of had known at the time that it was going to be a really tight victory, and I had to meet very certain conditions to get there. And so the war that the Huns and the Greeks cooked up was really a big wrench into my plan, threw a big wrench into my plans because it wrecked my trading strategy. I mean, I was relying on all these trade routes to power my economy and to buy things, to rush build things, because that's how Venice operates. So, I mean, this is kind of a preview of the Civ 5 AI and how it thinks and operates. I know there's some players who feel like they prefer the Civ 4 AI, which was somewhat more predictable. Can be hard to play against, but generally predictable. Some say rational, but I don't necessarily agree with that. But basically, the Civ 5 AI knows, kind of, has a good idea of what your strategy is by just looking at what you're doing. So in this case, they made the right call, because if they had not declared war on me, I would be in a much better place. But because they did, I'm in a much worse place. So, anyways, I did. It's May, and Firaxis recently announced Civ 6 would be coming out later this year. So that kind of kick-started the whole thing, series of things. And usually, with announcements of sequels, people go back and play the previous iteration of the game. I think there was 80,000 people playing on a Saturday morning on Steam when I checked. So, I mean, that's really big numbers for Civ 5. It's in the top 10 still on Steam. I know a couple of years after it came out, and it was like averaging 50, 60,000 on a good weekend, and 80,000 is a pretty huge number. So, it had a huge impact. I think the announcement on player enthusiasm. So, about the war, it was epic, and I'm kind of sad I didn't record it, but at the same time, I'm kind of glad I didn't record it because I got to just watch. Geez, look at this. Okay, these are nuclear fallout, so they're having a huge fight here over between Egypt and Greece. So I am glad I didn't record it because it just gave me a huge block of time. I didn't have to worry about ending the recording. I didn't have to worry about taking a break in between turns and not coming back and to play it, and worrying about pausing. So I got to, and I actually got to turn up the music too, which I really enjoy. And if you've watched an earlier episode of the Venice Let's Play, the reason why I turned off the music was there were a lot of predatory YouTube digital content management rights claims that was coming through, and they were tagging my Civ 5 videos for having basically classical music and allegedly licensed music that was playing in the background. So, I know a lot of other Civ 5 Let's Plays have just basically deleted the whole soundtrack, including the commentary of their videos as a protest against YouTube. So, I've turned down the sound, so you only have the sound effects and ambient sound. So I got to play during the wars with Egypt and no, sorry, not Egypt, but Huns and Greece. I got to play the music because I didn't have to worry about it, and as I wasn't recording. But I'll just run you through what happened in the war. So the war started out really badly. So they were attacking Byblos and Malthus. So again, this is kind of a Civ 5 AI quirk, or improvement, I would call it. They don't really give up. If they've made a strategic decision to take a town or city, they will throw everything they have at it until the AI decides to change. And they do change cities because initially they're attacking this city, and then they switch and attack this city, and then they switch and attack this city. So I think the end of the last video, they started attacking this city first. So they've captured and I've recaptured this city back and forth several times now throughout the war. So, I mean, this city is, you can see here, size 6, because, instead of a size 15 or 20, because it's changed hands so many times. And I lost the city at one point as well. I lost the city at one point. But I just ground it down. I did here. My war with Greece didn't go very well because I really had no way of supporting my Riga, which is a city-state that I had purchased. As the Greek fleet was about to attack it, I just sold it to the Polynesians, which had only one city left, their Honolulu. So I just kind of gave it up and got some money out of it instead. that's kind of my loss as well. I still have the holdings here. I've always wanted to take this city, but I never really found it strategically important. But I guess I should. But my navy is pretty much wrecked. I have this ship here and my one lone battleship. My destroyers, my other ships, they all got sunk. I even had two submarines at one point. They're all sunk. And I haven't had time to put in money for resources because I'm at peace with Greece now. And I roped in the Egyptians to attack the Greeks. So the Greeks are getting their ass handed to them right now. You can see here, nukes everywhere, flying everywhere. Their score is significantly below what they were at one point. They were way above mine, so I've actually clawed my way up to rank 2. So after I made peace with Greece and roped in the Egyptians, my war with the Huns started to turn in my favor. So I actually captured this city here. Captured this city, this city. I captured all these cities here. I liberated Lisbon, so I created, I brought them back to life because the Portuguese were taken over. And if you remember, the Danes were also taken over early in the game, so I've resurrected them. So both their capital cities are back under control. I did this as part of my strategy to get the diplomatic victory. So right now I have exactly 30 votes. I need 42 to win. The Danes and the Portuguese will give me their 4 each, so I have 38. I need 4 more votes. So how do I get to the 4 votes? Take Jerusalem, take Panama City, or I research globalization and plant a spy. Let me see, where's my tech tree here? Here's globalization. So, and then I research that and plant spies, sorry, not spies, diplomats in friendly capitals, and that will give me one vote per embassy or friendly diplomats in those cities. So I have some flexibility here. I haven't decided yet to go all out. It's been close because I'm actually behind on a tech race, and Egypt has pretty much researched everything, so they could launch the spaceship at any point. And I have about 20 turns to pull this off. So I think this is a loss, probably. The Egyptians have incredible production, especially with the AI bonuses at this difficulty level. So not hopeful, but I'm still trying to get that those spaceship parts built. I've only built the one and one half. I do have some money saved up, and that's part of the reason why I don't have a navy, is I'm saving all my money to buy research. Sorry, to buy spaceship parts. So I did talk about that in the last episode when I said that that's what I was going for in terms of social policy. So I did get there, space procurement. So I filled in pretty much everything I want here. So yeah, we're pretty much at the end game here, and I felt like I should at least try to show the ending here because the beginning was a long slog, and it would be nice to see what happens at the end. So let's see here, how many people are close? Yeah, Alexander is actually very close to winning. So they could still win this if they build this last part here, but they're like I said, their cities are being nuked. Egypt is sort of close, but they're two parts away. I'm right here. That's me. So I have to build these three parts, and I still need to research these two texts to get these two last parts to go. So we'll see. I think it's a rough. It's gonna be a rough go. Let's see here. So I'm gonna do this because in the hopes that the AI will channel some of their production to do this, and instead of building the spaceship parts, and because the Egyptians and the Greeks have already caught up on science, it's not really going to help them all that much. But it'll help me if I were to even just get silver. So let's go there. Let's do that. How much do I have to spend for one of these parts? $3,000 per part. That's expensive. So one of the issues with the AI is they're not really still very good with tactical unit placement. In Civ 4, all they have to do is throw all their units into a big stack and throw them at your city. So, I mean, it's an ongoing criticism of the game. Some people feel like this is a step back, but I really like the strategic element. Yes, obviously the AI isn't going to be as good at doing it as the human player, but that's kind of what the production bonuses are, because even in the old Civ 4, Civ 4 and older type games where you stack your units, it's still always an issue of the AI sending the wrong mix of units, not using their range units correctly, all sorts of issues with the AI was never resolved. So, I mean, this is in a way a different kind of problem than what people had to face in the past, but it's still more or less, I think, a more interesting way to approach Civ than what we had before. And you know, Civ, I think I've said this before, but Civ, in a way, is a game that is about progress. It's about technology and science, but a big appeal of Civ and a big part of Civ is warfare. I mean, like most of the game's units have always been war, military units. It's only been until very recently that we have like great people as units, and other civilian units taking place of military units, or not really taking the place of military units, but kind of making up the balance of the units in a game. So it used to be maybe 90% of the units were military. Maybe we're down to around 70% now being military, with the 30% being civilian units like trade units, workers, great people, and other you know, great artists and all that stuff. So we're kind of in that range now. I think 70% is actually really generous. It's probably not 70%. It's closer to 80 still, I would think. And this is just me pulling a number out of my head. So let's see here. Yeah, so for my gambit to work, I have 19 turns to pull it off. I have to at least take Jerusalem, so I have 19 turns to take over these two cities. And I don't really have a lot of cash to spare, because my backup is the spaceship victory, so I'm trying to save as much money as possible. So I've been losing units here and there, and I'm getting worried that I'm gonna spread myself really thin here. So I'm trying to not lose any more units. In the last couple of turns before I started recording, I lost a couple of infantry units that were really stupid moves on my part. I overextended them and all that stuff. So let's see here if I can get these going. So this will unlock Jerusalem for me. And I didn't see show you this, but when I took Joinville. That's a really funny name. The Huns had their atomic bombs parked here, so the AI is a program to move their aircraft away from the city as soon as they think the city is in danger. So usually, a big hint for them that their city is in danger is if the health bar is at yellow or below. So I had to kind of, you can kind of game the system or trick the AI by positioning all your range units kind of in range, but not quite in range, and kind of take off a few ticks from the health bar just to get it started, and then just rush in the next turn, like throw all your range units at it, throw all your bombers, and just take it all down in one go. And that way you can catch your air force if they have a big concentration of air power in one city, to take it by surprise. And it's always a prize to take their nuclear arsenal, because those take a lot of resources to build, and if you take those out, they're harder to replace than just taking their units out. So that's a big deal. And I've done that to them, and I have a little nuke here as my own deterrent. Because I don't think the AI counts how many nukes you have. Maybe they do in the background somewhere, but at least in terms of international recognition, as soon as you build your nuke, first nuke, the smaller civs that don't have it start to become afraid of you.
He'll die.
And like you can see here, they're afraid. They fear our great might here. So yeah, as soon as you build your first bomb, and it doesn't scale with how many bombs you have, other civs start fearing you. So I did that as kind of a diplomatic modifier on my part, just to get the AI to, you know, signal the AI that I have my bomb. And I've been lucky, because the Greeks and Huns both had their arsenal, and they never nuke use it on me, because I was always pushing forward, moving my troops near their cities. So if they're going to use it on my troops, they're going to nuke their own city. So they never did it. The Greeks actually tried to sneak some nuclear missiles through their subs through here while we were fighting here, and it sunk their ships. So that probably cost them a lot of resources too. But again, at this difficulty level, the AI has so much production that it probably is not a big as big of a setback as I think it is, but it's still, I think, significant enough to celebrate, or at least not celebrate, but you know, to recognize that it's a setback for them, and it's going to take them a while to get that production back. So I really have no interest in taking any of these cities. I'm just going to leave it there. Because I've effectively cut their empire in half at this point. And with the AI, with going to war with the AI, there's always tipping points with them. So in peacetime, they build up a large army. Think of it like a battery. They save up a lot of units. So when you go to war, they start spending those units, right? So they come in waves. In the old Civ games, they usually just throw everything they have at you. So there were all these gambits and strategies where, like, you cornered your stack of doom into one corner and use some kind of trick. There are various tricks depending on which AI we're dealing with. I think in Civ 3 there was a trick where an AI would never attack an army because it thinks it's too strong, but even though
the impact of nanotechnology,
they could have a stack of like 100 units, but they would never attack your army. So back in the old days, you basically, the trick was to lock up their stack of doom in a corner so that you can kill them off. Obviously, you can't do that in this game anymore, so the trick now is just to withstand the waves. So they'll come at you in waves, and then, so I think the first 20 turns of this war was just brutal, because they were just throwing everything. Like, I would kill 5 units, and the next turn another 5 would show up. It would just come in waves. But we're at the point now, at the tipping point now, where I've basically cleared off most of the units, so there's not much left. So the units I see coming up are basically units that show up as they are produced, so new units that were produced recently. So I'm seeing one or two units, so as long as I keep killing one or two units each turn, I think I'm on a good footing to keep him down, like to keep down the AI from doing more damage or from recovering, because the last thing I want is to be surprised, like to have like a huge Hunnic army show up. And I think he does have some reserves probably for his capital city, but we're not going anywhere near his capital city. We're gonna swing north here to take Jerusalem and maybe Panama City. So it's a bit tricky here. That. Let's do globalization. I should be more worried about this than I am. There has to be a barbarian camp here somewhere. love these stealth bombers. They sound so cool when they're flying around. And they're almost impervious to anti-air, because until I get my stealth bombers, my regular bombers were getting shot down. Or there was a high risk of them getting shot down, so I if there were a lot of anti-air from the AI, I would try to avoid them. And I think the stealth bomber implementation in Civ 5 is probably one of the best implementations of stealth bombers in a Civ game, because just the scale of the map and their range fits perfectly. In the previous games, I think Civ 3 comes to mind, the maps were much larger and the range of the stealth bombers were just not big enough to cover it, so it felt like the air power was really weird, kind of one-sided. Oh, that's a bad move. Damn, that's a really bad move. Oof. That's what happens when you try to talk and record at the same time. I'm gonna lose this unit here. Is there anything I can do? Yeah, this one doesn't have to range. But I'm gonna move this up here. Yeah, that's a terrible move. Well, at least it was a free anti-air unit that it got from one of my a city-state allies. Oh, well, they use their nuke on me now. pull my workers here. To clean up this mess. The other nice thing about stealth bombers is you can keep them well back from nuclear range, usually, unless the AI has nuclear missiles. So you can strike from deep in your territory. These are paratroopers, and as a tie-in to 2K's and Firaxis' XCOM franchise, the upgrade to paratroopers are XCOM squads, so you can basically deploy these. These are like infantry units that you can deploy into enemy territory by air. It's a lot of fun to use them. They're quite strong too, so I'm going to save this guy here for later. I'm going to move him up to Maltos. Thank you.
Jak ci się podoba moja oferta?
Ireis considerar esta oferta? Ireis...
Yeah, you can see here, gain one additional delegate in the World Congress for every spy as a diplomat in another civilization's capital. Well, I'm a little bit worried about what the AI is doing here, so I'm just going to try to knock out whatever they're trying to do here. I think they're trying to shuffle their units and move up from here. It surprised me. There's two diplomats I can use. So let's move Mogadishu to Lisbon as a diplomat and move him to Copenhagen. As a diplomat. And I'm picking the Portuguese and the Danish here as diplomats because they're very unlikely to declare war on me.
Aloha mai e ke hoa. Ke ho olo he nei au. He mai, e paira pū ka po e o kāua. He mai, e paira pū ka po e o kāua.
Glad I'm getting these new units to replace my losses, but I just keep getting anti-air. I'm guessing this is another anti-air unit. Liberate it. There we go. Two more votes for our Senate. The AI also has a really weird attachment to building a lot of aircraft carriers with no planes on it, and then they park it like right next to you. I'm not really sure what it's doing internally, but I think it's just a way for the AI to handle aircraft carriers, because basically I think what they're thinking is they want to have a lot of platforms out in sea to manage wherever they can launch your planes. If they can find a way to launch your planes, they'll do it. So I think that's what they're thinking. It costs a lot of production, but to the AI, that extra production is probably not a lot, or not as much as what it would cost a human player. In range for Panama City? No, I'm not in range, so I'm gonna move these over. Just really worried that this is gonna... You're gonna send nuke to one of these cities here. So I'll try to split them up. Oh, it's a tank. Goody. Let's upgrade that. Yeah, this is the unit we got from one of our city-state allies. Alright.
Ah, and now Ant. ثم
Pozdrawiam cię. Słucham.
Oh, there's a second nuke. Well, if the AI is doing that, I know they're getting desperate. And it's not like I want to keep going to war with the Huns, but I have my strategic goals, which is to take Panama City. I could, if I can get them off from the peace treaty, I would. So, having been nuked twice now, I'm feeling a little bit annoyed. So I might use my own nukes. So I went from, oh, public desire for new ideology, jeez. See if we can see for peace here.
من كرلسنا كان يجن
they don't want to give us Panama City. Ah, this is sucking. This is gonna suck.
Kai?
Malovkin, anak di ted.
Aloha mai e ke.
Ah, and now Ant. Summa?
He'll die.
Bons dias. Sou todo ouvidos.
What a mess. That was a setback, but we're gonna keep pushing on towards our ultimate goal. So I do have a gambit to play here. The Hawaiians have proposed world freedom as freedom as the world ideology. So if I dump all my votes there, I could potentially get it to happen, because the other vote is my vote, which is for an International Space Station.
No electronic.
Okay. And we have two more turns, so hopefully I can get two more votes from Panama City. I think they're about to nuke here, so if I have to act quickly, take the city, turn it into a city-state, they likely won't nuke it. My objectives have been accomplished. I'm going to sue for peace. Now I want your furs. 200 gold. Alright, we have peace.
Thank you.
That could have been a lot worse. With the barbarians. Okay, I think I want to show the ending here, but I think we're running long in terms of episode length, and the next episode definitely should see the ending of this series. Thank you very much for watching. We'll see you next time.